Well, it's great to be here with old friends and new ones. Each of the logos on the slide represents voices like yours, voices of pragmatism and practicality. And I think it's extremely important to have convene meetings like this that are projected out into the world, not just in this room, so that we can gather those voices and prioritize the sort of things that we're talking about here today. We're trying to recreate species from information alone. There are two organisms that have been recreated from information alone. They're both hybrids. They're not perfectly exact copies of what went extinct. One of them we recreated, or were recreated, from our own genomes, meaning that every one of us contains lots of pieces of retroviruses, and these were reconstructed into a living retrovirus, long extinct. And the other one was rescued from a human that had died from 1918 flu virus and was buried in the permafrost, and this was brought back to life. And the study of these viruses could save millions of lives in the future. Now, how do we predict the cost of this project? This comes up a few times. How do we predict the cost of any technology that's changing rapidly? The best way to predict the future is to change the future. And this is, we've noticed in at the end of the genome project, the cost improvement, which had been going along at a slow clip, could have flatlined because of the loss of the genome project funding. Or it could have gone on this aggressive exponential, similar to computers, pretty aggressive. 6 decades, we could have brought the cost down from $3 billion to the current cost around $2,000. I've given it away. The current cost arrived not in 6 decades, but in 6 years. We can only hope that such things happen to bring down the cost of projects like this. And if they do, it's because we're drafting behind this incredible powerhouse of human medical genomics to deliver into environmental habitat preservation and species de-extinction. Now, I'm going to break the process down into 3 very simple steps. One of them is raw DNA synthesis, trying to get those basic information out of the computer and into DNA. Then the next step is DNA delivery on the next slide, and then the third slide will be once the DNA is delivered to the right, roughly the right place, of splicing it into the genome perfectly, not just putting it some extra random place. So the best, the cheapest we can do for raw DNA synthesis is on the order of 1 to 200 base pairs, millions of those things on a chip made similar to chips in your phone, on the order of hundreds of dollars per chip. So you can make 600 million base pairs on a chip for hundreds of dollars. But then you have to do steps 2 and 3. You have to deliver the DNA. We can deliver single base changes scattered all over the genome, or we can deliver big chunks of DNA, up to 10 million base pairs, by either a process called cage or by microcell chromosome transfer. This is kind of this is where we stand right now in terms of, and is probably adequate, but it will improve by factors of 10, just as sequencing and synthesis have. Now, the third step is splicing this in very precisely. In 1990, the first human trials on gene therapy were approved by the FDA. They were not precise. They approved putting in random pieces of DNA that added to your genome to fix rare genetic disorders. That had the unfortunate consequence of causing cancer in some people, and so it was short-lived. 6 years later, introduced the first really amazing way of doing targeted change, which was the zinc finger nucleases, and these have dominated for the 17 years since. But a new actor has appeared in the field. My group and others have introduced this CRISPR technology, and I could spend an entire hour or two on this, but just 1 second. It's now not just protein-guided with the 3 fingers of the zinc finger illustrated, but it's an RNA-guided nuclease. The nuclease cuts the DNA, and then you can either just get rid of the DNA or introduce something new. So those are the 3 ways that we see changing rapidly in a very positive way for human gene therapy. Now, here's an application. How does HIV get into humans, and what can we do about it? It gets into humans via the CCR5 gene, which is present on all of our T cells, almost all of our T cells, and this is it gets in and it causes one of the greatest epidemics in human history, and extremely sad. And many of these are multi-drug resistant and vaccine resistant. Here's those fingers again. Now, not three fingers, but eight fingers, binding and a nuclease in the middle. This is a hybrid molecule. It's a hybrid between a mammalian set of zinc fingers and a bacterial nuclease. And it's going in and it's making a hybrid genome. You can go into patients, take out their T cells, delete both copies, both their mother's and father's copy of the CCR5 gene, put them back into the AIDS patient. The AIDS patient is cured and is resistant to future AIDS infection, HIV. So this is an example of the kind of motivation for developing this technology, which will have spin-offs in exactly the fields that we're talking about here today. This is an example of that surface of that cell where the AIDS virus is binding. And this is one of the first patients in a previous study, but this is now inspired and expanded to a full phase one and now phase two clinical trial from the company Sangamo, which makes these zinc finger nucleases that cleave and alter both copies of the CCR5 gene. So this is real, not science fiction, and is potentially applicable to endangered and extinct species. I think it's important to lump these together, the endangered and the extinct, and habitat preservation. All of these, synthetic biology has hopefully something good to say and to contribute if we all behave responsibly and meet as we are now. The Tasmanian devil has kind of the opposite problem of humans. It has too little immune diversity. And so there's actually a transmissible cancer that they kind of bite each other when they're fighting. And normally that would just cause a few cuts, but this now transmits a cancer. It's actually a Tasmanian devil cells go from one to another. And we heard in an earlier talk that we want the Tasmanian devil to help us bring back the thylacine. So you might be able to get a little diversity from existing Tasmanian devils, or you could go back and get from information that we can get from extinct dead versions of these and introduce that diversity. So as I said, humans have the opposite problem. They have too much immune diversity, at least too much from the standpoint of transplantation. If you want to get an organ donor, you have to search the world over to find somebody. And even then, the lines are very long, and it's a very unfortunate. But we can increase or decrease diversity by looking at this little set of genes on chromosome 6 of humans, and there's a corresponding chromosome in the Tasmanian devils and all of the animals we're talking about here today. You can go in and change as little as 2 to 5 of these genes to increase the diversity of the Tasmanian devil, or a few more genes, and you can make the tissue that you want to transplant, the stem cells that you want to turn into organs and transplant, compatible with just about any human without having to find a specific donor. Small number of genes can make amazing differences in both of these two species. Sergei Zimov has been telling us, at least since 2005, of the potential impending threat to the entire world that comes from the threat to the Arctic carbon. There's more carbon sequestered in the grasses and other things in the Arctic than all of the rainforest burnt to the ground. I don't recommend this, but it's hypothetical. Times 2.5. So, and it's not just, and it doesn't require burning the tundra, it just requires melting it, which is currently happening, as you can see in some of the slides from the other speakers. So, this is mammoths are hypothetically a solution to this, but we need to explore whether this is the only solution or or even adequate one. Getting rid of the dead grass, stomping down the trees, and stomping down the insulating snow in the winter so the Arctic freeze can get into the permafrost. These are the sort of things that could be achieved uniquely by mammoths. And so Sergei Zimov and his colleagues have created a Pleistocene park that's currently populated by much smaller mammals. We would propose to make a hybrid elephant that has the best features of modern elephants and the best features of mammoths. We have enough of a mammoth genome and enough information in computers about many other species to know the key physiological features that we need to introduce into elephants so that they will be happy year-round in the Arctic regions of Canada and Russia. Many of these have actually, maybe to some people's surprise, have already been recreated. Five different gene variants have been tested, either molecularly or in cells, including blood hemoglobin and genes involved in hair color. And we want to get at other ones even more vital to the cold, having to do with subcutaneous fat and sebaceous glands, which amazingly elephants don't have. They have short, stubby, bristly hair that causes cooling rather than the insulation that we actually want. Developmental biology is currently one of the big pushes forward for synthetic biology, and it's going quite well. Spectacular results already, even though we're just starting. Here's an example of a mouse incisor, which with just three changes in the genes, in the spry genes, can become very tusk-like in the lower example where you have the three mutations from UCSF. We can learn from many animals, not just from the mammoth DNA, but from developmental biology in many animals, including humans. Here are two human mutants that cover this huge range of hair, ranging from very sparse hair, kind of like what you see in the elephant tail and legs on the left-hand side, to very woolly and body-covered hair, as we see in the mammoth as well. And so we'd like to bring these back. And then finally, the 22-month gestation period of the elephant is one of many challenges, small challenges, that we need to overcome. But we have various tools. You've seen some already, not just in my talk and others, where we can test a few genes at a time in molecularly, cellularly, or in increasingly in organs and systems, again, being developed for human health. We want to be able to develop organs in the lab so that we can use them for transplantation. And you can test out whether what you think is going to create the subcutaneous fat layer or the woolly hair is there. And these are examples of tests from stem cells, actually from my own body in the case of the ones on the right, where you can generate almost every tissue in the laboratory, either in mice or in tissue culture. So again, what's important is for this community to come together and hear your voices of practicality and pragmatism and what you want to see done and how. Thank you very much.